cryptography is kind of composed of two main goals: information privacy authentication. It kind of has these two parts. You might want to verify the identity of someone sending the message, and that also kind of goes along with making sure that the message hasn't been tampered with. So basically, keeping information private, and then also you want to know if you get a message that this is really the message that came from the person that I think it came from. We'll start off with just a quick example. This is called the Caesar cipher, or a Caesar shift, and it was actually used by Julius Caesar, though probably other people before. It's not too complicated an idea. Basically, we have what's called the plain text, and so that's letters that are kind of unencrypted, and the cipher text is sort of the letters that are sort of hidden somehow. And basically, the cipher text is just the same as the plain text, which we just have here, the alphabet, 26 letters, but it's shifted by some amount. In this case, it's shifted by, I think, 9 to the right, unless I'm mistaken, and 17 or 17 to the left, depending. And so in order to encode a letter, you just basically take that letter and you shift it 17 to the right in the alphabet, which is basically, this is just addition mod 26. So in order to get the ciphertext, you just add 17 mod 26, where you can view the letters, of course, as like 0, 1, 2, up to 25. And in order to decrypt, you just take the ciphertext and you subtract 17 mod 26, which is the same as adding 9. This is an example of a private key crypto system. That is, you have some secret bit of information that you can use to encode or decode, and then you hope that someone without that information cannot decode the message. So in this case, the secret key, as it's called, is basically the number that you shift by, so maybe 17 would be the secret key in this case. And then if you know that 17 is the secret key, and your friend knows 17 is the secret key, you can take your message, shift all the letters by 17, and then give it to your friend, and your friend will be able to decode it. Could anybody else decode it, though? Probably. So you could actually, like, even you as a human, not even with a computer, you could actually try all 26 possibilities, and that's called a brute force attack. So a brute force attack is basically just try all possibilities until you find the one that works. And since there's only 26 possibilities, a brute force attack would be very fast on this. Basically, in any of these secret key schemes, you have some sort of encoding function and some sort of decoding function. And the functions are going to basically take plain text messages and map them to ciphertext in some way. An alphabet, in general, is just a finite set of symbols. And a symbol can be anything. So this is an alphabet, of course. This is also an alphabet. You just need any set of symbols that you can distinguish from each other. This could be your alphabet. You could just have an alphabet of just 0 and 1. Yes and no could be your alphabet. And in this case, we consider yes as a symbol, right? If we were talking about using an alphabet like this, Y would be a symbol, E would be a symbol. But in this alphabet, yes is just a single symbol. And in general, whatever you like. Any finite set of symbols could be an alphabet. For the case of the Caesar cipher, we have the encoding function. It's usually denoted by a letter E. And we often use this capital sigma to represent an alphabet. So in this case, it was this alphabet. And the encoding function is a function that maps the alphabet basically to itself. E is a function, and a function just takes some kind of thing and gives you back some other kind of thing. So in general, if you have a function f, this means f takes things in the set x, and it gives you back a thing in y. And, I mean, the function, most generally, could be specified by a huge table where you have a list of all the things in x, whatever, and then the corresponding thing in y, and this would be, so in the case of the Caesar shift, we actually did give a table to specify the function exactly. So this specifies a function. And then the notation, it just means E is a function that takes the 26-letter alphabet to itself. So the encoding function here is if we have some secret key that tells the shift. So in this case, I think it was 17. So the encoding function, it goes from the alphabet to itself, and it maps any letter X. This arrow here just means maps to. So it means X goes to X plus 17 mod 26. And we can also write this same idea as just so these are just two notations for telling you what the function does. And then similarly, we have a decoding function. And what's the decoding function in this case? Yep. Which is the same as x plus 9 mod 26. So we could also write this as x maps to x minus mod 26. So in general, for any secret key crypto system, we'll have encoding and decoding functions, but they need to have a certain relationship with each other, right? So we certainly need the fact that if you decode an encoding of X, you get X. So in other words, somehow the decoding function should sort of reverse the encoding function. So in this case, we say that D and E are inverses. So technically, we also need the property that if you to get that they're inverses, but we get that for free here because we have the same size alphabets. I think that you are also probably familiar with another simple example that's kind of a more general version of the Caesar cipher. You can basically permute the alphabet and get something like this. We have this sort of mapping from the plain text alphabet to the ciphertext alphabet. And you'll notice that this is just the alphabet in any random order. It's not just shifted. So it could be shifted. That would be a special case of this. But more generally, you could have any permutation down here. So this seems like it's probably a better crypto system. A brute force attack would not work in this case. There are just too many possibilities. If you try putting this number into your calculator, it will probably explode. Instead, we have to be a bit more clever. You can still do a frequency attack. I'll come back to this in a second. By basically knowing that certain letters in the alphabet appear much more often than others. So if you just look here, you can see, for instance, that if a letter appears often, it has a very, very low probability of being a J. Unless, of course, somebody is writing a message with a lot of J's in it for some reason. But generally, if a letter's appearing very often, you could guess, as somebody did, that it's an E. And this actually completely breaks the crypto system. So using a frequency attack based on this information, so this is for English, but of course, if you knew that it was in a different language, you could have a similar table. You can actually break these kinds of codes even if there's no spaces. So still using just the 26-letter alphabet, again, our encoding function, it just takes a letter in the alphabet and maps it to another letter. And this mapping is just given by some kind of table, which has a permutation of the alphabet, which we could call pi. So we could have pi being this table. Pi is often used to just denote a permutation, such as we just saw. So, and then again, the decoding function is just the inverse, which you could get by just taking the table and swapping the sides. And so the secret key is just the permutation given as a table. And as we saw, you can actually break it without the key. So how could we make this system stronger? Instead of having somehow a function that just looks at any letter in your message the same, you can basically have kind of a different function defined for the first letter and the second letter and the third letter. And this is actually completely secure. Before I talk about this more, though, there is something else that you can do that's a bit more secure, that's sort of similar to the things that we've seen before. So mapping one letter to multiple letters is something that you can do. If we have a letter that maps to multiple letters, we can get rid of the frequency problem. But we can't have our alphabet that we use for our plain text the same as the alphabet we use for the ciphertext. Because if these alphabets are the same size, then we won't have enough things over here, right? Because you certainly can't have two letters mapping to the same because you won't know how to decode it. If you're going to have a letter having multiple possible mappings, you need to make this bigger. And that's not really a problem. I mean, most of the time, we're actually not working with letters, we're working with numbers, but we can easily use letters in this case. We'll just define another alphabet that just has every pair of letters. So, in this case, our encoding function is going to be a probabilistic function, so it will map things from the 26-letter alphabet to things in this larger alphabet, and we might have there's a whole set of things that A can map to. And since A is pretty frequent, maybe A will map to fewer things than or to more things than some infrequent letter, right? Because we want the frequencies to sort of disappear. And so basically, every time we see an A, we'll flip one of those three-sided coins, you know, and we'll decide which of these three things to use. And we can easily encode, because all of these will only come from A, but A goes to multiple things. So this is still not completely secure, but it's much more secure than we had before. What you could do is think of every letter as a number, and then you are going to multiply them all by some amount. Now, you can't just multiply them by some arbitrarily large thing, because first of all, you have some kind of space constraints, right? If you multiply by something huge, you're going to have a bunch of huge numbers. So what you would have to actually do is multiply mod some reasonable sized m. So you could say your encoding function, basically you have some a, and you multiply everything by a, and take the result mod m. You would have to do something like this because you can't just let them be arbitrarily large. And in particular, actually, if you did let them be arbitrarily large, you could still guess the size of A based on the size of all the, because you know that X is something that's pretty small. It's something between 0 and 25. And so you could kind of guess the size of A. So we'll just think about this as AX mod some M, where M is sort of like the maximum that we're going to allow these things to grow. And M will have to be something that's small enough that like we can reasonably store all of these things. But that means that there's actually only M possibilities for A. So you could actually try all M of them. M can't be too big because you need to be able to store all of these things. So that would probably not be super secure as well. The things that we've seen so far have been, we have an encryption function that takes letters of the alphabet to letters of the alphabet. We can also have encryption functions. So this notation here, it means basically all of the strings of length n from this alphabet. So for instance, if we have some alphabet AB, then we can look at all the strings of length 2 in that alphabet. Those are just all of the ordered pairs of these two letters. So this is all of the strings over this alphabet of length 2. English words, you can see them as strings in this alphabet of, say, arbitrary length. And so we use this notation. This is all the strings of length n over this alphabet sigma. And we also have one more bit of notation. Sigma star is all of the strings of any length over the alphabet sigma. So for instance, you recognize this alphabet. This is just the binary alphabet. And if we put a star here, this means all binary strings of any finite length. So we can sort of generalize the ideas that we've seen before, and we can have an encryption function that actually takes a whole string of some length, and then it gives you a string of possibly a different length, possibly over a completely different alphabet. And this has the potential to be more secure, and we'll see an example of where it is much more secure. This is just the substitution cipher again, an example of a substitution cipher. You have the plain text alphabet, and then there's a permutation. And you can look at the key as being the table that gives you the permutation, but you could also look at the key as being 26 values that you just add mod 26, depending on the letter that you see. So if you had a message and you're encoding it, you would go, okay, first letter, it's an H. What is my key for H, etc. So, oh, my second letter is an I, so what's the key for I? So this is the substitution cipher we just saw. This is just a different way of looking at it. But the new idea that we've sort of been hinting at is that instead of having this one function that we apply to any letter in our message, we actually have a function that changes at each letter. So we can look at that as if we have, we'll just use this alphabet. So we want to encode a message of length, let's say 20. And if this were just a permutation of all of the like words of length 20, and by word, maybe it's a sentence, and it were actually just a permutation, then it would be completely secure because you couldn't tell, if you got any word of length 20, you would have no idea what word it came from of length 20. But if we wanted to store this enormous thing, it would be a huge table. So we have a simpler thing that accomplishes the same, because we don't want to encode every possible message. We just want to encode this one message that I have right now. So we don't need to store a huge table. Instead, we just have a different key, not for each letter of the alphabet, but for each letter of the message. In this case, I go, okay, the first letter of my message is D. What's the key for my first letter? 12? Okay, it's going to be a P. The next letter is E. What's the key for the second letter? It's not the key for E. It's just the key for whatever my second letter is. Notice that I use the same key here. That's fine. Even though this is an O and this is an E, it doesn't matter. The key is related to the location in the message and not to what that letter happens to be. So you even notice that here M maps to U and E also maps to U, but that's fine. Because when your friend goes to decode this message, they're not going to look at this and say, oh, it's a U. What is a U? They're going to say, oh, this is the second letter, so I should subtract 16. And then they will get E. This is called a one-time pad, and it's completely secure, which I'll talk about in a minute. But first, the simplest possible example is you meet with your friend, and she's like, hey, do you want to hang out later? And you're like, I don't know. I'll call you tonight, and I'll tell you. And then you're like, oh, but my neighbor's always listening to my phone calls, so we have to encode this somehow. So you're going to tell her yes or no, and you're either going to say what you mean, or you're going to say the opposite of what you mean. So you and your friend decide together either that you're going to say what you mean or you're going to say the opposite of what you mean. So you decide, you maybe flip a coin, and the coin says you're going to say the opposite. So you go home and you think about it, and you decide, yes, I want to hang out with my friend. So you call her and you say no. But she knows that no means yes, because you guys decided that it was opposite day. So in this situation, if your neighbors are listening in on your call, and they hear you say no, they have no idea if you meant no or yes, because they don't know if you were going to say the thing you meant or the thing you didn't mean. Sorry, what was that? On the other hand, maybe your neighbors know that you know that they're listening in. And so they assume that you're going to say the opposite. But then they're like, wait, what if she knows that we assume that, so she says the real thing? And then, right, so it could be either. In this case, there were two possible messages that they wanted to send. Yes and no. And this is basically the same as 0 and 1. So we'll just, that probably makes more sense. Okay, so basically you want to send a bit to someone, and so you decide on a key, and that key is also going to be a bit. So in the case that I just said, you guys decided that you were going to flip your answer, and we represent that with a key that's a 1. Then later you decided, so you now have the shared bit. So we have Alice and Bob. These are our cryptography characters. So Alice and Bob both decide on the key K equals 1. Alice goes home and she decides that her answer is yes. So her message that she wants to send Bob is a 1. Now, she has decided that she's going to flip the 1. And that's the same as actually adding these mod 2. Okay, if you add a 1 to anything, mod 2, it's going to switch it. and if you add a zero, it's going to do nothing as adding zero always does. So Alice has her ciphertext zero. She sends it over to Bob. He can actually do the same thing. He just adds the key and ciphertext. And the key is basically, it's a one, but what it means is flip the bit. And so Bob adds these mod two, which is the same as flipping the bit, and he gets the message one. If we had an alphabet of size bigger than two, then we would have adding here, subtracting here. But because we're using binary, it's actually really nice. You can just add mod two in both cases. This operation, actually, addition mod two, is often denoted like this. It's sometimes called an exclusive OR or XOR. And it has this really nice property that basically if you add a 1 to something, it flips it. And if you add a 0 to something, it does nothing. So now let's suppose Eve was listening to their conversation. Eve was eavesdropping. And so she knows C equals 0. Can she learn M if she knows K? But if she doesn't know K, she has no idea what M is. Because if K were 1, M would be 1. But if K were 0, M would be 0. So in other words, M could be 0 or 1. In other words, M could be anything in the message space. So this is completely hidden. And we can generalize this. We can use it on any alphabet like this by just doing arithmetic modulo the size of the alphabet. But in general, we'll just talk about it on a binary string. So we can do another example. So suppose you wanted to send your PIN number to a friend of yours. They had your bank card for some reason, and they wanted to get money out of your account, and you were cool with that. So. And you, of course, you guys probably all have like shared secret key with all your friends, I assume. So it was no problem. Your PIN number is 5555, and you want to encode it. So first, we're going to convert this to binary. I see some people with calculators out. I mean, I have it here, but I don't want to ruin anybody's fun. It's a little bit tedious, but. And what's the last bit?
One.
Why is the last bit one? And we'll just put a little two there to just denote that we're using base two for this number. I might forget to do that sometimes, but it'll be clear. Okay, so here's your PIN number now in binary. This is not encoded at all because binary is sort of well known. We need a secret key. We'll assume that you already have a secret key with your friends, but let's just come up with one now. Okay, so this is our key. Now we want to come up with our cipher text. To get our cipher text, we're just going to have addition mod 2, but for each bit, which means basically we're not going to have any carryover. So we just look at the first bit. It's going to be 1. And why is it going to be 1? So there's two reasons it's going to be 1. They're the same reason, but two ways of looking at it. 1 plus 0 is 1, mod anything. But also, we can also look at it as our message has a bit 1 here, and our key has a 0. And remember, 0 means don't flip the bit. So we look at this bit, and then we don't flip it. Because our instruction says don't flip the bit. So we get a 1. And then this bit here is going to be 0. Again, two reasons. 1 plus 1 is 2, which is 0 mod 2. Also, we have a 1 and we have an instruction flip that 1. So we flip the 1 and it becomes a 0. So we can continue in this way to get a ciphertext. So now, I claim that if you send the ciphertext and somebody who does not have the key sees this, they have no idea what the message is. So to see why, if we have the same ciphertext, you could, for instance, construct a key such that the message would decode to anything, but in particular, a string of just zeros, or any message. So for any arbitrary message that we put here, any binary message of the same length, you can take the ciphertext and come up with some key that would give you that message. In this case, it would just be the message. So you can see that basically as addition mod 2, right? Zero just does nothing. We had this message that we wanted to encrypt, and we use this key. And we can assume that we choose this key completely randomly, and we get this ciphertext. Now, if an eavesdropper gets the ciphertext, they cannot learn anything about the message, because for any message, this is just a completely different message, they can find a key such that the ciphertext would decrypt to that message under the key. So if they see the ciphertext, they can't even rule out a message. So for instance, if an eavesdropper got hold of the ciphertext, they couldn't rule out that perhaps the PIN number was actually 2222, or perhaps it was 3124. So basically, any string, anything that encodes as a binary string of this length, is still a possibility given the ciphertext. And therefore, they can't learn the message. They can't rule out that it is this message, but they can't rule out that it's any other message either. And so this is completely secure. So why don't we use it all the time? There's something called the key distribution problem, which is exactly what it sounds like. You can't reuse the key because then this becomes less secure. So you actually have to have a key that's the same length as your message, and you have to communicate it in a secure way so an eavesdropper can't find it out. So why didn't you just give the message at that point? I mean, there are lots of scenarios where, in my weird earlier scenario, where Alice and Bob met, but they didn't know what the answer was going to be yet, so they just exchanged a key and then later sent the message. And, I mean, you can think of the same thing if you wanted to do online banking using this. You wouldn't have to go into your bank every single time you wanted to send them a message. You could go in, like, once a year and get a whole bunch of key and then just use it for the year. I mean, probably in practice you could, I mean, unless you do a ridiculous amount of online banking, you could probably get a lifetime's worth of key in one go. Just get a big hard drive and fill it with a really long binary string. But it's obviously not ideal for this reason. You have to have this sort of secure exchange before you can have any secure communication. And you might think, well, if any secure exchange is possible, then this wasn't necessary at all. So there's a solution. Well, there's two solutions, actually. One is way better, and you're going to learn about it in the quantum cryptography lectures. But the solution currently in practice right now, which is totally classical, is public key cryptography. Just as the name suggests, there's a public key. Now, obviously, you can't just make the key that you need to decode a message public, because then anybody can decode a message. That's obviously not good. So instead, in a what's called a public key crypto system, there are two keys. Before, we had this one key K that we used to encode and we used to decode. But in the public key crypto system, we have a public key that's used to encode. So it's public, that means anyone can encode. But there's a different key that's not made public. It's often called the private key or the secret key, and it's used to decode. PK is the public key, and SK is the secret key. And so we have an encryption function again. It's going to take some kind of message. And it also will take a public key. So this is a magic box that if you put a message and a public key in it, it will give you a ciphertext. And then we have a decryption function. You can always think of a function as a magic box like this. It's often called a black box. The decryption function is going to take a ciphertext and a secret key, and it will give you a message back. So you can imagine that there's some public bulletin board that has this public key on it, and then anybody who wants can encode a message. So maybe I will have a, on my website, I'll say, if anybody wants to send me messages, here's my public key. And then anybody can use that. They have their black box, and they put in the message they want to send and the public key, which I've given the whole world, and they get out a ciphertext. And then they can send the ciphertext to me. Everybody sees the ciphertext, but the decryption box requires a secret key, and I won't tell anybody the secret key. One thing, the public key and the private key have to be related. If they're not related at all, like if they're just two completely independent numbers, then there's no way this could work. So somehow, I mean, the fact that this is this process here is taking C and giving you out M, it means that somehow the secret key has to kind of know the private key, and the private key has to kind of know the secret key. So they have to be related, and you can figure out one from the other. But we have to specifically find pairs of related numbers that we can do this with, where it's really difficult to find a secret key given a public key. So basically we have these kind of processes where it's really easy to generate these pairs, but it's really difficult to go backwards. So given one, find the other, or something like that. So for instance, you might have heard that factoring is really hard. On the other hand, it's really easy to multiply two numbers. So, I mean, factoring is actually only believed to be hard. Nobody knows for sure that it's hard, but we don't know of a good way of doing it. So a computer using the best known methods couldn't factor a large number. I mean, if you have a sufficiently large number, and it would probably only need to be a few hundred bits, you couldn't factor that number in the time remaining in the life of the universe. So, I mean, we're talking like not possible at all using the known methods. Even though multiplication is easy, factoring is hard. So that's just one example of a problem where it's easy to go one way, but it's difficult to go back. This will probably all be clearer when I give you a different example in a second of how you can have these sort of related key pairs but not be able to get one from the other. We have Alice and Bob. Alice wants to send Bob a message. So she says, "Hey Bob, I want to send you a message." And then Bob says, "Okay." And he sends her a public key. And then she computes a ciphertext, which is going to be a function of the public key and the message that she wants to send. And then she sends that to Bob. And then Bob, he knows the secret key. that corresponds to the public key because he generated them. And so he can compute the message. Using the secret key. Okay, so for like a credit card transaction or something, you have a public key that's somehow tied to your computer. And so, and of course, whoever you're transacting with will have a public key. And I mean, you don't know about this, but your computers are communicating, and this is all going on underneath. So I guess probably you're buying something, and the online shop where you're buying it will say, I want your credit card number. Here's my public key. And then you will encode your credit card number using their public key and whatever the standard is that they're using, which is probably something called RSA, which is the one that involves factoring, though we're not going to discuss that today. But, and then you'll send that over, and then they can decrypt it. So one possible problem is that somebody could actually just say, oh, I'm an online shop, here's my public key, and they're not actually the online shop. They're just giving you their public key so that you think you're encrypting stuff so that eBay or whatever can read it, but you're actually encrypting it so that Eve can read it, some eavesdropper who's trying to steal your credit card. So that's why something that we're gonna talk about later, authentication, is a way of somebody will send you a public key and proof that it's their public key so that you know when you encrypt it that only they will be able to read it. It's pretty successful, I guess. I mean, people don't break these. So, for example, the thing I'm going to show you, which is called the Diffie-Hellman crypto system, there's a special case of it that is used in things like cell phones because it's very efficient. And so it's a very widely used standard. And there's this research company that works on the technology, and they actually have challenges where they have examples of the public key, and they're kind of like, okay, break this, like find the secret key, and we'll give you $1 million if you do. But nobody, I mean, they've been out for, I think, at least 10 years now, maybe longer. And people, they always have like little easy problems that you can get started on, and people have broken those. But the ones that are actually, they're actually paying millions for, nobody's broken them. And people are trying, like people have these huge networks of PlayStations, because that's how you get a very, very parallel machine, is you network as many PlayStations as you want, and then you have all these processors. And people have like these enormous networks of PlayStations working together with all that computational power of many PlayStations to try to break these things so that they can get $1 million. And I mean, so far it's been at least 10 years and they haven't. So they're pretty successful. Okay, so this is called the, what I'm gonna show you is actually, it's a public key system. And the reason I'm showing you this one is it's kind of nice. It actually exchanges a key. So it actually ends with Alice and Bob having a shared key that they can then use to send messages. So it's an example of a public key system, but it's also kind of related to the stuff that we saw before. It's a public key way of getting shared key that can then be used for encryption. So there's some public parameters that are just kind of chosen in a way that will make this secure. P is some prime number, and G is just some integer. And everybody knows them, and maybe there's other people also using the system. They're maybe using the same P and the same G. This is some sort of public bulletin board where everybody can read the messages. So Alice first is going to choose a random integer mod P. And then she's going to compute big A, which is going to be small g to the small a mod p. And she sends that over to Bob. Bob chooses some small b mod p. Notice that a and b are both non-zero. and he computes Big B and sends that over to Alice. And they both compute a shared key. And their shared key is G to the AB, which they can both compute. And notice that the information that they sent between each other, we consider that public. They could have been yelling it across the room to each other or talking on an unencrypted phone. So that information is public, but we assume somehow that if somebody looks at the public information, they can't figure out K. So now you see, I mean, of course, in theory, they could figure out K. I mean, let's see, they have G to the A, which is big A, and they have G to the B, and they could figure out A and B by taking the logarithm, which in this case we call it, because it's mod P, it's called the discrete logarithm. So they could figure out A is just the log of that base G. And there are algorithms for computing this. So looking at the public information, you could try to run an algorithm that would give you small a, and then you could just take this to the small a, etc. However, if we choose p large enough, we actually think that this is really hard to take this discrete log. I mean, no one has proven that it's difficult. And actually, in practice, to make it harder, they do work in a slightly different setting and modify the parameters a bit. But the point is, it's very easy to take a power mod p. There are very efficient algorithms for doing that. However, taking the log mod p is something that's very difficult. And the best known algorithms we have in the settings where this is actually used in practice, they're not that much better than just choosing a random thing, taking g to that power, and seeing if it gives you like g to the a. So you could choose a random r and then see, does g to the r equal a? If so, you know that r is small a. But you would have to try a lot of things and the universe would end while you were still working. Let's try to look at this in this kind of framework here. So this just exchanges keys. How could we look at this as a system for sending messages? What is Bob's secret key here? Small b? And what's his public key? Big B? Okay, so then Alice wants to send this message M. So how does she encode M into a ciphertext? In other words, what is the ciphertext that she's going to send over? So G to the AB is going to be part of the ciphertext. And then we need to involve the message. You just multiply it and would be, yeah. Just a way to kind of mask it, and everything's mod p. Well, everything's mod p, I won't write it, but all the operations are mod p. Okay, so now what's the whole ciphertext gonna be? So we could say Alice has some a, but we'll just maybe rewrite this as, this is b to the small a. Now, if this gets sent over, Bob needs to be able to get the message out. So how would Bob get the message if he just got C, and if this was just C? So in this case, it hasn't been sent over yet. We need to actually put it into the ciphertext. So this is actually the whole ciphertext. It's a pair of things. Okay, so it's some big B to some small a times the message, and then G to the small a also. And Alice sends that whole thing over. Now Bob needs to figure out the message from this information. Bob can calculate some k is a to the small b, where this is a, just as on the slide. And then, and he can do this because he has small b, because he generated it. And he has big A, it's right here, as part of the ciphertext that gets sent over. So he has b to the a m, he knows this whole thing. And he divides it by a to the b, which is equal to b to the a, which is k, yeah. So notice that this requires that all the operations that we expect Alice and Bob to do should be easy. So for instance, multiplication should be easy, and it is. Division should be easy. Now this is division mod p, so that means finding some value. If we have 1 over x mod p, let's say this is a value y such that x times y is 1 mod p. So that's what division means mod p. It means finding this value that if you multiply it with the original thing, it gives you a 1. But that's easy as well. But we need the operations that we hope no one will do, such as looking at the public information and getting secret information. We need those to be hard. So it's pretty difficult to come up with one of these crypto systems. I mean, you have to come up with a setting where all of the things you want to do are easy, but there are also some hard things involved to prevent people from breaking your system. And even in this case, you know, we don't have a good way of computing the discrete logarithm that would allow you to figure out the small a from big A or small b from big B. But maybe there's one. Well, I mean, obviously aside from the quantum algorithm. So people make assumptions about these problems being hard. These are called computational assumptions. And all public key systems, they have to be based on computational assumptions, necessarily. Because you will always have this situation where you have some encryption function and you will always have to assume that going this way maybe is easy, but going back way is hard. You have to assume that it's hard to go the reverse direction. And by hard, we mean hard for whatever computer exists. So there are always these assumptions involved. And for instance, people thought that factoring was very difficult. I mean, they don't even know if it's difficult for a classical computer. But there's a very efficient quantum algorithm for factoring. So when we build a quantum computer, then the RSA, which is relies on the hardness of factoring, it just won't work anymore. Anyone who has a quantum computer will be able to break it. So though these are used in practice, and I mean they're certainly really good for some things, and there are still some systems that there's no way known that even a quantum computer can break them, they're always based on some kind of assumption, which means that they're not completely secure. And there's another problem. I mean, computers are getting better all the time. You know, maybe we'll have a quantum computer and, okay, I'm not going to say an amount of years with the camera on because I don't want anyone to quote me. But, you know, in some number of years, we'll have a quantum computer. but maybe later we'll have some kind of computer that we can't even imagine now. And the problem is, if somebody saved all of the information going back and forth between Alice and Bob, maybe it will be 100 years later, but if this is some sort of very important secret government information, you might want it to be secret that long. And so if you've saved this and now a computer comes along that can do discrete log, you can take your old copy that you have of big A, put it into that computer, and it will tell you small a. And then in particular, you can look at any messages, any ciphertext that have gone back and forth, and you can compute the messages. So if somebody were to invent some kind of computer tomorrow that breaks whatever crypto system we're using for our public key cryptography, all of our past messages, if anyone's kept them, they can decode them. And that might not be so desirable. So I think I'm going to kind of end here, because the next topic is authentication, which I will probably be good to start in the afternoon session. But I will go to my last slide, just since it's come up. Actually, the biggest, the weakest link in most secure systems is actually people leaving their passwords lying around. So that's actually where most security breaches come from. I mean, even though, you know, there's all this, when we build a quantum computer, all of our credit card systems will fail. But if you leave your, like, online banking password, like, sitting on your desk at work, that's probably worse. There are weaker links, maybe, but this stuff is obviously still important. We certainly don't want the actual systems being used to be the weakest links in the security.